from Hollywood, the Hollywood Radio Theater. Starring Judy Garland and John Lund in Lady in the Dark. Ladies and gentlemen, your producer, Mr. Irving Cummings.
Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight we are delighted to have as our guests John Lund, who has given us so many excellent performances, and Judy Garland with her inimitable voice that reaches the heart of everyone who hears it. We will present these two fine artists in Lady in the Dark, the stage hit written by Morse Hart and made into a sparkling screen hit by Paramount Pictures. And of course you'll hear the delightful music of Kurt Weill and Ira Gershwin. Now, Lady in the Dark, starring Judy Garland as Liza Elliott and John Lund as Charlie Johnson. This is the story of Liza Elliott, the sophisticated editor of Allure, America's most elegant fashion magazine. Liza's a little late for work this morning, and the reason is a rather disturbing interview she's just had with her family doctor.
Morning, Miss Elliott.
Hello, Foster.
Oh, Dr. Harris just phoned.
But I just left Dr. Harris.
Well, he said you forgot to take Dr. Brooks' address.
Dr. Brooks is a psychoanalyst, and I refuse to see him. It's a perfectly ridiculous situation. Now, let's get to work.
Oh, Mr. Russell wants to see you right away. And those dresses we're to photograph just came in, and there are three people waiting.
Liza, you have got to do something. You have simply got to do something.
All right, Russell, what now?
I am in a frenzy, a frenzy. Either he leaves, or you get another boy to shoot your pictures.
He? Who?
Mr. Charlie Johnson, that's who. Last night when I should be shooting pictures, Johnson takes out all our models. Two of them haven't even shown up yet. And the others, bags under their eyes down to here.
Well, please, Russell, do the best you can.
Oh, I'm so mad I could spit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Phooey! Oh, good morning, Maggie.
Hi. Liza?
Come in, Maggie.
Well, what's it all about?
Charlie Johnson. Maggie, if Johnson weren't the best advertising man in the business,
well,
I
Maggie,
swear...
Maggie, you want a gooey kiss?
Oh, why don't you stop being a pixie?
Look here, Johnson. I just saw Russell. If you've got to take out models, try Harper's Bazaar. If you have business to talk over, let's get to the point.
Boss lady, you kill me. It's just a matter of our next issue. I got a great idea. A circus number. Cover, layout, articles, everything. All a la circus.
Our next issue is the Easter anniversary issue.
Yeah, I know, but just for fun, I had the art department work up a dummy. Here, look. Swell, huh?
Oh, a circus theme isn't even remotely right for a fashion magazine.
Anything's right if it brings in the ads. I'll sound out the department stores and find
You'll do nothing without my okay.
Oh? And when do you suppose I might get that?
When I'm ready, I'll send for you.
Well, what do you know?
What?
Your suit. It's just like mine. We must go to the same tailor.
You?
A paperweight. Always wanted a paperweight. Thank you, boss lady. Maggie, come on in.
Now, look here, Charlie. What are you trying to do to Liza?
Nothing at all. She's just sore because I'm wise to her.
Wise about what?
Ever see a brick house that really isn't made of bricks? The bricks are just painted on? Well, that's Liza Elliott in that big executive pose of hers. And I just can't resist chipping off little hunks to see what's underneath.
Well, you can just cut it out. Liza's not feeling well. And you'll be decent to her, do you hear?
Why doesn't she quit? Our publisher's in love with her. Why doesn't she marry him?
You know as well as I do that Kendall Nesbitt can't get a divorce. So shut up.
She can still quit. I've had my eye on that job of hers ever since I came here. A girl like Liza shouldn't try to be top man. She's not built for it. Look, you want me to apologize to boss lady?
You wouldn't. Besides, she's gone home. Well, good night, you stinker.
Good night, sweetheart.
Kendall. Come in.
Hello, Liza.
I thought you had that publisher's dinner tonight.
I have, but I wanted to find out what the doctor told you.
Well, I'm a very disappointing medical case. It seems to be all in my mind.
There's nothing wrong.
No, what?
Then why are you worrying, darling?
Worrying?
You were just humming, and when you start humming...
Oh, here, now that's silly.
You are worried, Liza, and it's all my fault. My dear, when I think what we might have had...
Oh, darling, please.
I should have bowed out of your life long ago.
Oh, don't say that. Don't ever say that. I'm perfectly happy. I don't know what I'd do without you, Kendall.
Thank you, darling. Well...
I'll see you tomorrow at the office.
Of course. And try to get some sleep, huh?
I'll try, dear.
Good night, Liza.
That melody. What is it? What is it? It means something to me, but I can't remember. I can't remember. Martha! Martha!
Yes, miss?
Come here, please. Call Dr. Harris for me. Tell him I want Dr. Brooks' phone number. Now, Martha, right away.
Now, what else can you tell me about yourself, Miss Elliot?
It's fear, Dr. Brooks. I'm afraid. All day long, I'm in kind of a panic.
Ever think of stopping work?
Well, I couldn't. The magazine's the only steadying influence I have.
Well, what about you and this Mr. Nesbitt you mentioned?
I see no point in being schoolgirlish about it. Mr. Nesbitt and I... Well, we can't get married because his wife won't give him a divorce. Look, I came here hoping you'd be able to help me. Do you think you can?
Perhaps. I'd like a trial analysis for a month, starting now.
Well, that's impossible. I'll be terribly busy for the next few days.
In that case, I suggest you find someone else.
All right. What do I do?
Well, I want you to lie down there and start talking. Anything at all that comes to mind.
Meanwhile, you'll get into your beard, I trust.
Start talking. What are you thinking about?
I'm thinking about a song. A little song I knew as a child. I dreamed about it last night.
What kind of a dream, Miss Elliot?
I was all alone in a vast, misty cloud, and all around me was the song. I was dressed in blue, a blue gown, the most beautiful gown I'd ever seen. I felt I was the loveliest creature on earth.
Does the color blue mean anything to you?
Well, that's just it. I really dislike blue intensely. Anyway, the mist suddenly disappeared, and there I was, standing on a huge stage. I'd just made a speech. The crowd was cheering me. I was the center of attention. Thank you, thank you. Oh, how lovely to be me. If there's a party, I want to be the host of it. If there's a haunted house, I want to be the ghost of it. If I'm in town, I want to be the toast of it. Oh, how lovely to be me.
A message.
Who bears a message?
I do. I, Mr. Charlie Johnson. From the President of the United States to Miss Liza Elliott.
And?
The President requests that for national unity and for the advancement of cultural achievement...
Yes?
...that your portrait be painted for the new 2-cent stamp of the U.S. Hooray!
Oh, how really, really lovely. And who is to paint me and where?
I am to paint you, and here.
In this dress, like this?
Exactly. The most beautiful, the most enchanting, the most fabulous woman in the world.
Oh, how true, how true.
A chair for Miss Elliott. No, not a chair. A throne for Miss Elliott.
A throne? How charming. Now, what about
a coat of sable for her lovely shoulders. Diadems and flowers. No. One flower, a single rose.
Red, white, pale pink, yellow.
No, a blue rose, drooping with humidity in this hand of indescribable grace.
Oh, lovely, perfectly lovely. Now, about my pose, don't you think I should...
Just as you are. Oh, Miss Elliott, what wordless wonder you reflect.
Yes, I know. But my hair, I never pose unless...
As I see it beyond perfection, my brush shall capture
every gleaming highlight.
Yes, but my feet. Now, if I crossed my feet, I think that it would... Well, don't you agree? I mean...
Miss Elliot, I beseech you, indulge me. Let me complete the portrait before the inspiration leaves me.
Oh. No interruptions?
No interruptions. I'll be done in 3 more strokes, like this, and dusty, and so.
The grace of the bump and the looks of the year. Oh, girl of the moment, you're my moment every time.
I have completed the portrait of a goddess. Look, multitude, observe, admiring throng. Here at last is the true picture of Miss Liza Elliott.
Why, it's a caricature. A caricature.
Is it? What's the matter, boss lady? Can't you take it?
Go away. Go away. Go away! It was horrible, Dr. Brooks. I woke up sobbing and shaking.
Well, it appears that in your dream you were just the opposite of your real self.
Opposite?
Obviously, you're a girl who cares little for feminine adornments. Yet, in the dream, you were glamorous, seductive. You've never wanted to be that alluring woman?
Never. The only thing I ever wanted was to make something of myself.
Most girls want love and marriage.
Well, I didn't. And I despised girls who did.
Why?
I don't remember.
Or you don't want to remember, which?
I simply don't know.
Well, I think we've done enough for one visit.
And that's all there is to it?
For the moment, yes. I'll call you soon.
Thank you. Well, good night, Dr. Brooks. All right, Johnson, what do you want?
Do you happen to have the time, Miss Elliot?
It's 20 minutes after 3.
I thought our staff meeting was set for 3.
It was. Well, where is everybody?
In Russell's office.
What's so important in Russell's office?
Why, Miss Elliot, Randy Curtis is there, getting photographed. Everybody's there.
Then you'll kindly remind everybody that I had called a staff meeting and I intend to have a staff meeting.
Are you kidding? Randy Curtis is a movie star.
Well, we've had celebrities here before.
Say, incidentally, what about my circus idea? The department stores like it very much.
We'll talk about it at the staff meeting, if there's such a thing possible. Wait here, Johnson. I'll be right back.
That's what you think.
So if you don't mind, get back to your desks immediately. I'm thoroughly ashamed of you. I'm terribly sorry this happened, Mr. Curtis. You'd think they'd never seen a movie star before.
Oh, it's okay. I'm used to it by now. You're Miss Elliot, aren't you?
Yes.
You don't remember me. Mrs. Brackett's cocktail party about a year ago.
Oh, of course.
We were going to have dinner sometime. We still could, you know.
Why, I think that might be very nice sometime.
Oh, Mr. Curtis.
Yeah?
Mr. Curtis, may I have your autograph?
Look, you're kidding.
Oh, no. I save all sorts of things. Autographs, paperweights. I put them in a memory box, and on rainy afternoons, I just sit and stare at them. Please?
Okay, here you are for stormy weather.
Gee, thanks.
Oh, Mr. Curtis, telephone for you.
I'll be right there. Excuse me, Miss Elliot.
Dream lover, put your arms around me.
Boss lady, sometimes you kill me.
I don't like you, Johnson. And I'm definitely repelled by what you consider amusing. If you can't confine your remarks to your work, perhaps you can make better connections elsewhere.
My.
Liza, could I see you alone for a moment?
Well, our publisher.
Kendall, we're supposed to be having a staff meeting now.
I'll only take a moment. Let's go out on the terrace.
Just be careful, Kendall. Teacher's mad.
Don't worry. This isn't business.
Well, I changed my mind, Liza. I didn't go to the dinner last night. I decided to see Catherine and settle this one way or another. Well, she's agreed to a divorce.
Divorce?
Yes. It's what we've been waiting for, Liza. It's... Liza, dear, What's the matter?
Nothing, Kendall. It's just wonderful.
Look, why don't you get out of this office and run on home? You're not well. Johnson and Maggie can get out the magazine.
No, please. I'm all right.
I thought you'd be glad to hear the news.
But I am.
There you are. Well, Miss Elliot, I'm sorry.
That's quite all right. Randy Curtis, Kendall Nesbitt.
Oh, how do you do?
How do you do?
We were talking about dinner, Miss Elliot. Tomorrow night?
Well, I think tomorrow night would be fine. You'll have to call for me here, though, Mr. Curtis. I'll be working late.
Well, that's okay. That's fine. I'm glad you can make it. Well, goodbye again.
Goodbye, Mr. Nesbitt.
Bye.
Just wait till we're married, darling. You'll be able to forget all about staff meetings and movie actors and deadlines and everything. Except me, I hope.
Kendall, you're the sweetest man that ever lived. Just try to put up with me a little longer. Please, just a little longer.
We'll continue with this week's production of the Hollywood Radio Theater in just a moment. Make a friend, and you make an ally. There's a thought for you to keep in mind, as many another American has. Sam Higginbottom knew the value of that thought. Hearing of a missionary's work in India, Higginbottom decided he wanted to do something to help the poverty-stricken, uneducated natives, too. His idea was to stay there a few months, then return to America to finish his theological studies. But after a year in India, he decided to stay on indefinitely to help the people till their soil and improve their crops. For 5 years, Higginbottom and his wife, with their limited experience in farming and agriculture, worked hard to modernize the farming equipment and methods in India. Then Sam returned to America to study scientific farming. He interested many people in his Indian project, and by the time he received his Bachelor of Science in Agriculture, he'd raised $30,000 donated by fellow Americans in every walk of life to continue his work in India. When he returned there, Brahmins, princes, the untouchables, all shared equally in Higginbottom's knowledge. In 1928, his Princeton classmates paid his fare back to the States to present him with a Doctor of Philanthropy degree. And in 1940, he was named Doctor of Human Letters. Among Sam Higginbottom's keepsakes is a letter written by a personal friend in India. Your work is more than simple help. It is good nation building. The letter was signed Mahatma Gandhi. How well Sam Higginbottom had proved that by helping others, you help your country. Now our producer, Mr. Cummings.
Act two of Lady in the Dark, starring Judy Garland as Liza and John Lund as Charlie Johnson. The sudden news that Kendall Nesbitt soon would be free to marry her leaves Liza in a complete state of jitters. She struggles through a miserable night, and now she's back in Dr. Brooks's office, telling the psychoanalyst all about it.
So you've had another dream, Miss Elliot.
It was grotesque, fantastic, but so terribly real. The people, the singing, the wedding procession.
Oh, I see. Wedding.
I dreamed it was my wedding. Dozens of men were crowding all around me, laughing, dancing, flirting men.
Again, the center of attraction, the beautiful, glamorous woman.
Well, presently all the men vanished but one. He put his arms around me. He made love to me. It was Randy Curtis.
You resented his lovemaking?
No. No, I didn't, not at all. Then suddenly I found myself in front of an altar. In back of it, grinning at me, was one of the men from the magazine, an especially annoying person called Johnson. He seemed to be a judge or a minister. I looked around for Randy, but he was gone. Another man was standing there, stretching out his hand to me. It was Kendall Nesbitt.
Oh, yes. Your publisher.
Yes. Then the people began chanting. They said I wasn't the true Liza Elliott. They demanded I tell the truth. Tell the truth. Well, it was awful. I started to run. They laughed at me, and then it all turned misty and blurred, and I woke up, shaking as usual. I'm still shaking.
You told me that Mr. Nesbitt is getting a divorce.
Yes.
Had you ever been aware before now that you did not want him to get a divorce?
You're very clever, Dr. Brooks. No, I was never aware of that before. But it's true.
You mentioned a dinner engagement with Mr. Curtis for tonight.
Yes, but I'm going to call it off.
Why?
Because I haven't the slightest desire to keep it.
In your dream, you're ready to marry him, yet now you reject him. It's a rather curious denial.
Is it?
Also, in your dream, you suddenly see it is not Randy Curtis at your side, but Nesbitt, and immediately the mocking voices of the people are heard. They taunt you. Your dream becomes a nightmare, and you run away.
Yes?
Miss Elliot, hasn't your affection for Kendall Nesbitt been based on the fact that he resembles your father?
My father? Why, I never even mentioned my father to you.
And isn't it true that you've transferred your love for your father to Nesbitt? And as long as he remained married, you were safe.
Safe? Safe from what?
From having to compete with other women. But the moment you were faced with becoming his wife...
Oh, that's horrible. That's not true.
But it is. You're afraid to compete with other women. It's clearly indicated in your dreams at your...
But that's all they are, dreams. And your interpretations of them, nothing else.
I think you'll find the interpretations fairly accurate.
Well, I refuse to go on with this. Thank you, Dr. Brooks. Just send a bill for what I owe you.
Oh, boss lady, you got a minute, maybe?
Can it wait, Johnson?
It waited all morning, then it waited all afternoon, and now it's 6 o'clock. Where have you been?
I've been out.
Oh. Well, the big stores like my circus idea. Looks like I'll leave your magazine in a blaze of glory.
Leave?
Oh, now, please, no tears. Just a light kiss on the cheek, perhaps, and a quick goodbye,
Well, you're certainly thin-skinned, aren't you?
Me? Because you bawled me out? Oh, no. I just got a better offer.
I'll meet that offer.
Why? I annoy the life out of you, don't I?
That has nothing to do with the way you do your job.
Look, it isn't a question of money. I'm getting something I could never get here. Your job. I'm afraid that's what I want.
Well, it's nice of you to be so frank.
Yeah, I'm ambitious, too. I want to run this magazine. But you married that desk of yours years ago, and you're never going to get a divorce. You have magazines instead of babies.
Well, you insolent... I'm sick and tired of that incredible sideshow you put on under the guise of the gay young man with a wicked tongue. It doesn't always excuse your being an ill-mannered boor, and I question if that isn't the extent of your talent.
Rage is a pretty good substitute for love, isn't it?
Get out of here!
Yes, ma'am. Oh, if we should ever need a good man over there, I'll make you an offer.
Liza!
Hello, Kendall.
Darling, where have you been? I've been searching for you all day.
I've been to a psychoanalyst.
A what?
I'd stood just about all I could stand. And then I walked out on him. And I kept walking and walking and walking.
Liza, be honest with me, will you? You don't want to marry me. That's true, isn't it?
Oh, Kendall, I...
There's someone else?
No, I can't explain it to you. I can't explain it even to myself. Kendall, I'm sick. I'm ill.
I know you're ill, Liza, but you're going to be well again. And you haven't the right to trifle with other people's lives, even with this as an excuse.
All right, what am I going to do?
Stop acting like a child.
Don't talk to me like that. I'm fighting as hard as I know how.
But I can't stand aside while you proceed to destroy something very important to me.
Oh, give me time, Kendall, please.
No, that's not facing it honestly.
All right. Come back for me in a little while. I'll get through here as soon as I can. But don't push me in a corner, Kendall. It's no use.
I'm going to fight too, Liza. I love you. I can't help that, can I? Oh, Mr. Curtis is waiting for you. Something about a dinner engagement?
Mr. Curtis? Oh, dear, I forgot to call him.
I'll send him in.
Thank you, Kendall.
Well, it looks as if
if I'm early. Sorry, Miss Elliot.
No, no, it's my fault, Mr. Curtis. I've been snowed under. I haven't even had a chance to change.
Say, you know what?
What?
Let's go out just as you are.
Just as I am?
No, but you look wonderful. You know, to tell the truth, I was scared stiff I was going to run into a glamour girl.
Oh? Well, just the same, I'm going to dress. Now, if you don't mind waiting outside.
Hmm? Oh, sure. You just take your time.
Yes?
Maggie? Do you have those sample dresses from Bergdorf's?
Liza? Yes, sure.
Send them right in. I was scared stiff, he said. Scared stiff I was going to run into a glamour girl. Just as I am, he said. He likes me just as I am.
Liza Elliott, what's the matter with you?
Nothing, darling. I'm just going out with Mr. Curtis.
Randy Curtis?
I'll show that Dr. Brooks who's afraid. Randy, that in 3 hours we've been to 6 different nightclubs.
And we haven't been alone for 2 minutes.
Well, you're a motion picture star. Too many people know you.
You know I have to laugh. 3 years ago, nobody would give me a job. Now I'm in with all the big shots. Writers ask me to read their books. Businessmen ask me about the market. And I even get a chance to meet you.
Randy, you're very endearing.
Liza, it isn't just this, my being in the movies that made you come out with me tonight.
No, Randy.
Oh, well. That's swell.
I really came out to prove something to myself.
Do I figure in that something?
Oh, yes. Yes, very much. This is new. I was merely existing. This is new. And I'm living at last, head to toe. You've got me so I'm spellbound. I don't know if I am heaven or hell bound. This is new. Is it Venus insisting that I'm through? The shadowy past, I am hurled up to another world where life is bliss, and this is new.
Liza, I know you've known me only a couple of days, but, well, it doesn't take time to know that a person is the only person you want to be with. From the first time I saw you a year ago, well, I'm crazy about you.
Randy, I'm not very good at this sort of thing.
Oh, I know you couldn't feel the way I do. Not yet. But do you think you could think about it?
I think so.
Oh, gosh. Gosh, Liza, oh.
Randy! Yeah,
hello.
I thought you went back to the coast.
Tomorrow. This Miss Liza...
Hello. But, darling, that's wonderful. So am I. Oh, you know Charlie Johnson?
Hi.
Good evening, Johnson.
Miss Elliot, you look wonderful.
Thank you.
This is the first time I've ever seen you like this. Actually, like a woman.
Now, what does that mean, Charlie? Oh, Randy, I saw Marie yesterday, and is she burned? You really shouldn't be so mean.
Hey, well, come on, will you?
Just a second. Excuse me. I'll be back in a minute.
Oh, sure.
Liza.
What?
I know you don't like me because I want your job. And I know you don't like her because she wants your man.
Randy, what time is it?
Why, it's early, 11:30.
11:30? Oh, I really must go. I have work to do.
Work? Well, couldn't you forget it, Liza? Just this once.
I don't think she could ever forget it, Mr. Curtis.
Randy, I really must go home.
Home? I thought it was work.
What is it, Liza? You all right?
It's nothing. Maybe I'm just tired. Please, you don't mind.
Oh, of course not.
What's the matter, boss lady? Can't you take it?
Well, good night, all.
Good night. What's he talking about?
Nothing. Nothing at all. Randy, if you don't mind, I'd like to go home alone.
Oh, well, will I see you tomorrow? I'll be leaving you now.
Well, call me, won't you?
And you'll think about what I said before?
Oh, I will. Yes. I think in a way, that's why I'd like to be alone.
Thanks, Liza.
In a few moments, we'll continue with Act Three of Lady in the Dark.
Make a friend, and you make an ally. There's a thought for you to keep in mind, as many another American has. After living a life of a moderately successful farmer, Otto Hunderwaddle, with his wife, accepted a job as agricultural advisor to the government of Burma. At first, the Burmese weren't too anxious to work with the Americans, and Otto finally discovered why. They considered him and his wife too old for work. But the Hunderwaddles proved that age had nothing to do with the ability to work. And then the men accepted his help with their drainage and agricultural problems. And Mrs. Hunderwaddle showed the skeptical women how to can food. She was so successful that eventually she and Otto got permission from the Burmese government to build a local cannery. Well, shortly after it was built, however, misfortune struck. Civil war broke out, and the Hunderwaddles and their helpers were forced to abandon their homes. By the time they returned, the cannery was a shambles. But they weren't discouraged. While Otto remained in Burma to help the villagers rebuild their homes, Mrs. Hunderwaddle returned to the United States to raise money for a new cannery. By the time she returned to Burma, she had secured more than enough money and equipment. When last heard from, she and Otto were still helping the Burmese farmers and working in the cannery, for they'd learned that by helping others, you help your country. We pause now for station identification.
The curtain rises on Act Three of Lady in the Dark, starring Judy Garland as Liza and John Lund as Charlie Johnson. Liza's home again, immersed in a mountain of papers, representing the Easter issue of Allure magazine. But now Liza's yawning. Her eyelids are fluttering. Her pencil drops from her fingers. Liza's fast asleep. And presently, she dreams a dream.
It's true, Miss Elliot. I'm a psychoanalyst. I know. You don't dare compete as a woman. You don't dare.
No, no.
Liza, I don't expect you to answer now. Do you think you could think about it?
Oh, I will, Randy.
You don't want to marry me. That's true, isn't it?
I can't explain it, Kendall. I can't. Oh, please.
It's my resignation, boss lady. Now, what about the circus idea? Come on, decide.
Decide. Decide on the cover. You've got to decide. The Easter cover or the circus cover? The Easter cover or the circus cover? The Easter cover or the circus cover? I'm not only at the circus, I'm in the circus. In the cage, I'm in the cage. Hey, let me out of here, let me out of here.
Ladies and gentlemen, your attention, please. Ladies and gentlemen.
Johnson, it's Charlie Johnson dressed like a ringmaster.
I take pride in introducing for the first time in history the captivating and tantalizing Liza Elliott. The woman who cannot make up her mind.
Order in the court. The charges against Liza Elliott.
What is all this? The charges against me for what?
Liza Elliott cannot make up her mind about the Easter cover or the circus cover. Liza Elliott cannot make up her mind whether she is marrying Kendall Nesbitt or not. Liza Elliott cannot make up her mind as to the kind of woman she wants to be, the executive or the enchantress. Therefore, Let Liza Elliott be brought to trial and made to make up her mind. I'll be attorney for the prosecution. My worthy opponent?
Well, where is he?
Introducing that thrilling writer and attorney for the defense, Randy Curtis.
My first witness, Your Honor, Kendall Nesbitt.
Here I am. I'm here. What's the question?
Mr. Nesbitt, you are divorcing your wife so you can be free to marry the defendant. Isn't that so?
Yes, sir.
And the defendant led you to believe she'd marry you when, as, and if?
Yes, sir.
Ha ha.
What do you mean, ha ha?
Tra-la, the rights of womankind, tra-la. Permit a change of mind when a maid gives her heart but does not give her word. How on earth can that maid have betrayed him? Ha ha!
You've heard the charges, Miss Elliott. Have you made up your mind about any of these things?
No, how can I?
Can you give a reasonable explanation? Why not?
I can't, I just can't.
Stop being evasive, there must be an explanation.
Oh, let me alone.
You see, Your Honor, the lady wants to be alone.
Very well. You want to be alone, Miss Elliott? All right. Be alone. Clear the courtroom. Get away from her, everybody. Get away.
Wait. Not everyone. Don't everyone leave me. Please, I'll tell you whatever. Gone. They're all gone. Come back. Come back. Don't leave me here alone. Don't leave me alone. It's getting dark and all misty again. And that music, I don't want to hear it. Who's playing that music? Stop it! Oh, please, stop! Stop! Father!
Father?
Help me, Father!
Liza, what are you talking about? This is Kendall.
Father, don't let them play that!
I'm not your father. What's the matter with you?
Make them stop it! Please, make them stop it! Help me! Help me, Father! Help me!
Hello? Dr. Brooks, please. Miss Elliott. Liza Elliott. What? Oh, would you give him a message, please? Tell Dr. Brooks that I must see him again. I've got to. In the morning? Yes. And thank you. Thank you very much. And I stood there, Dr. Brooks, terrified, pleading for my father. That song all around me, no one would help me. No one. Then the dream ended and I woke up.
And you think it was the song that upset you so?
Yes. It gave me that same feeling of hurt and humiliation I used to have as a child. I called it my bad feeling.
Can you remember when you first had this bad feeling?
Yes. I was about 6 years old. One night my mother and father were going out. Some men came to the house to call for them. My father brought me downstairs to meet them.
Well, here she is, everybody. Here's Liza. And she's going to sing for you.
Oh, Helen, surely that's not your child.
That's what they tell me.
But you're so gorgeous and she's so, well, what I mean is she doesn't look anything like you, not like Bob either.
I'm perfectly contented with Liza. One beauty in the family's enough for me.
It went on and on like that, Doctor. I wanted to shout, it's not true. It's not true. I am like my mother. But I just stood there, my heart broken.
Bob, we've simply got to go.
But Liza's going to sing, aren't you, dear? Come, darling. My ship has sails that are made of silk.
My ship has sails that are made of silk. The decks are trembling.
Liza! What's the matter, dear? Liza!
I ran to my room. I had to get away from them. From their laughter, I felt ugly.
and ashamed. A year later, my mother died. My poor father. I'd watch him sitting by himself hour after hour. The only way I knew how to take my mother's place was to try to look like her. So one evening I got out her blue evening gown, the one he loved the best.
A blue gown, I see.
At last I thought I was going to be able to do something to please him.
Liza, how dare you put on that dress? Take it off at once.
I had a terrible convulsive shock.
Don't ever do that again. Go back to your room. Go back.
My father, whom I loved so completely, had turned on me. I never tried to come close to him again. As I grew up, I buried myself in my schoolwork. I made up my mind if I couldn't be anything else, I was going to be tops in my class. I never went to parties or dances, except one. The graduation party at high school. I spent most of the evening wandering up and down the walk outside the gymnasium. And then I discovered I wasn't alone. Ben wasn't dancing either. Ben, who'd been chosen the handsomest boy in the class.
But what are you doing out here, Liza? I mean, how come you're not dancing?
Well, I had a headache.
Oh.
It's going away, though.
You feel like dancing now?
Well, I... Where's Barbara, Ben?
Barbara. We're not even speaking anymore. Honest, Liza, do you think a girl should flirt all the time?
Well, I imagine it's pretty difficult for Barbara not to flirt. She's so pretty.
You're much nicer than she ever was. Come on, Liza. Let's get back to the gym.
Well, if... If you'd like to, Ben.
What's that song, Liza?
What's a... Oh, that? That's just something I remember.
But it's nice. Go on. Sing it, Liza.
Oh, Ben.
Go on.
Well, all right. I don't know if I remember it all. Let's see now. My ship has sails that are made of silk. The decks are trimmed with gold. And of jam and spice, there's a paradise in the hold. My ship's aglow with a million pearls, and rubies fill each bin. And the sun sits high in a sapphire sky when my ship comes in. I can wait the years till it appears one fine day, one spring. But the pearls and such, they won't mean much if there's missing just one thing. I do not care if that day arrives, that dream may never be. If the ship I sing doesn't also bring my own true love to me. If the ship I sing doesn't also bring my own true love to me.
Pretty, Liza. Liza.
Hmm?
Look at me.
Why, Ben. Why, you kissed me.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right, Ben. But I guess we'd better hurry up if we want to get that dance.
Yeah.
That was
Quite a conquest, Miss Elliot. The handsomest boy in the class.
Don't be silly, Dr. Brooks.
Hmm?
As soon as we reached the gym, there was Barbara, wide-eyed and smiling. He took one look at her, and that's the last I saw of Ben.
Well, there certainly are a lot of pieces. Suppose I try to put them together. As a little girl, you convince yourself you're ugly, decidedly inferior. So you build a wall around yourself. As an older girl, you drop your defenses for one crucial moment, receive another cruel blow, and withdraw forever after as a woman.
Doctor, what does that mean, withdraw as a woman?
You resolved never again to risk being hurt in competing against other women. You buried all your painful memories, and with them, that little song which expresses the fulfillment of love. You escaped in a loveless world of work.
But it wasn't loveless. I loved Kendall Nesbitt.
No, Miss Elliot. You dominated him, just as you've attempted to dominate all men.
All right, what's the answer?
Perhaps a man who'll dominate you.
Oh, that's so silly, isn't it? That a grown woman should be governed by the desperate desires of childhood.
Do you agree with me?
Well, I feel better. Lots better.
Do you agree with me?
I don't know. I don't know.
Liza, can I come in?
Maggie, of course. Good morning.
Well, where is he? Foster told me that Randy Curtis was in here.
Oh, well, he just stepped out to telephone.
Hmm.
Hollywood's been paging him for hours. Oh, stop looking at me like an owl, Maggie. I just happened to run into him on the street after I left the doctor's office.
Well, well, well.
Yes, and I'm very glad I did. He's asked me to marry him.
Liza.
And you may not suspect it, Maggie, but Randy's a very domineering young man. So I'm giving up the magazine, and I'm giving up hiding and running away.
When did you ever run away?
Oh, lots of times. Only now I know why I ran. I wanted someone to lean on, to take care of me. Oh, Maggie, be happy for me, please. I think I've found the answer.
Darling, I am happy for you.
Thank you.
But while you're still the boss, there are a few things I'd like you to okay.
Just bring them in.
Right away. Whoops! Sorry.
Hello, Mag.
Kendall, come in.
Well, Liza, this is it, isn't it? Between us, I mean.
Yes, Kendall.
I guess I've known it for a long time. Well, maybe this is the best way. Only I'm afraid I'll never...
Mr. Curtis is through with his call.
Oh, Kendall...
Send him in, Miss Foster.
Liza, Liza, I've got great news. They want me to form my own producing unit. Make me the boss. Stories, productions, profits, everything.
Oh, why, that sounds wonderful, Randy. I don't know anything about the picture business.
Oh, it's simple, darling. It just means that you'll still be the boss.
The boss?
You'll be in back of me. I mean, well, if you'd be willing to take charge of everything, just like you are here, well, I'd tell him yes in a minute. Would you do it, Liza?
Randy,
I can't tell you what it means to me, knowing that I can be running to you for the rest of my life.
The rest of your life?
Now, just one kiss and I'll get out. Oh, I'll be back, though. Oh, gosh, thanks, Liza.
Thank you, Randy. And thank you for telling me.
Be back at 5.
Oh, hello, Mr. Curtis. Yeah. Liza, I demand a showdown, an immediate showdown. Do you realize what Johnson's done to me? He deliberately took my color plates.
Russell, not now.
Not now, not now. What am I supposed to do to get some attention around here? Bleed in front of you?
Russell, the dog department wants to see you.
Oh, that's good, that's fine. Really, I could spit. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Fui!
I'm supposed to apologize to you, Liza, for what I said the other day.
Who said so?
Maggie. She's a hard woman, Maggie.
All right, Johnson. Put him up. This is a kid's last fight.
But I've been thinking it over, and I've decided I'm not going to apologize. I know I've been pretty rotten to you, Liza, and I've kicked myself for it afterwards, but there's always been that secret battle between us, and I've always had to win it because, well, because I'm me, I guess.
Johnson,
I'm not finished. I just wanted you to know that in spite of all your shenanigans, I think you're fine. Oh, I turned in the Hattie Carnegie layout to Paxton, so I guess that washes me up.
Johnson, or Charlie, if I may. Do me a favor. Give me back my paperweight and stay, will you?
What?
Look, I know all your reasons for wanting to leave, but it seems as though I'm getting a divorce from myself. And I think you ought to stick around and see the fun. What do you say?
Sorry, but I'm sure it wouldn't work.
Oh, I see what you mean. Well, look, why don't we run the magazine together? After a while, I might even step aside. Well, that is if you don't get too drunk with power.
You mean that, Liza?
Yes, I want you to stay very, very much.
You got a minute? Here, now look at our format. The first thing I want to change is the format. You got a layout?
A layout? Yeah, on the desk, here.
Now look, instead of having the name on top...
Yes.
Why not put it over here?
All right, wait, just a minute. Maggie, come here, I want you to see something.
Coming.
Yeah, Charlie, we can't get this issue ready for Easter.
Sure we can. I got a dummy issue in my office. I'll be right back. Be nice to me, Maggie. I'm your boss now.
Would you mind telling me what the devil goes on around here?
Maggie, I almost made a great mistake. I almost twisted up my whole life all over again.
You did, huh?
I might have married Randy Curtis. I thought he was a refuge, a tower of strength. Well, you know the parts he plays. But do you know what, Maggie? He needs what Kendall needed. A mother, not a wife.
But you just said...
Maggie, I don't think you're going to have any worry about your Liza anymore. I think I'm going to be all right. Now go on, get out of here.
Well, I'll...
Excuse me, Mag. Well, here it is. You see what I mean? You see what it does to the whole magazine?
Yeah, yeah. Now just let me sit down.
No,
here.
I better sit down. What are you doing down there?
Just having a few laughs.
Well, get up, get up. Now look, we put the ads back here, see?
Yeah.
And the color section up in front. Now what about that? Sure, it sounds dangerous, but it could be great.
Oh, well, go on.
What did you say?
I said, go on and do what you were going to do.
Really?
Well, sure.
Baby, I've been waiting to do this for years.
Oh, Liza,
Well, this is the end. The absolute end.
In a moment, our stars will return.
When the 84th Engineering Corps was stationed south of Seoul in Korea, a young North Korean was employed in the kitchen. He was most appreciative of the work, cleaning vegetables, washing dishes, scrubbing the floor, for which he was paid about $15 a month. One morning, when he reported for work, he brought the news that a new baby had arrived during the night. Happy and proud as he was over the event, he confided in embarrassment that he and his wife had not been able to provide clothing for the child because there was nothing to buy in the stricken city. The young mess sergeant under whom he served wrote to his wife about all this, and she promptly bought an entire layette and sent it to her husband to give to the Korean parents. The Korean father, when handed the package, couldn't control his emotion and wept tears of joy that from so far away, such wonderful gifts should come to his small son. Such acts as these by you and your friends today are shaping our world of tomorrow. Now, here's Mr. Cummings with our stars.
And we want to thank them for such a wonderful evening. Judy Garland and John Ludd. John, I suppose Paramount is bursting with pride over their new Technicolor picture, The Stars Are Singing.
I hear Rosemary Clooney is simply wonderful in it.
Well, that's great praise from you, Judy.
And how about those two other wonderful singing stars in the picture? Anna Maria Alberghetti and Loritz Melchior.
Yes, Paramount's always been a leader in presenting fine talent. Two of its latest stars have won Academy Award nominations. Must be quite a thrill to receive a nomination.
Well, it's even more thrilling to receive an Academy Award without being nominated.
Would you mind unraveling that sentence?
Don't you remember, John? Judy received a special Academy Award one year for being the outstanding juvenile.
Oh, yeah, sure. I'll bet her performance in The Wizard of Oz had something to do with it.
And what a swell-deserved award. No one has ever forgotten Judy's singing of Over the Rainbow.
Well, many thanks for those kind words. But how about a few words for next week's show?
More singing, Judy. It's a tuneful, joyous comedy from the studios of 20th Century Fox. You're My Everything. And as our stars, we will have one of our best dramatic actors, who also is a celebrated song and dance man, Dan Daly. And as his co-star, truly one of the loveliest girls in Hollywood, Jean Crane.
Sounds great, Irving. Good night.
Good night.
Good night, and bless you.
Hollywood Radio Theater is a presentation of the United States Armed Forces Radio Service.